So when we start wanting to present the results from our data and our analysis at some form of table or graph, the first question we usually come across is, okay, what's the best way of presenting this data? How can I go about making this a good table or a good graph? Whenever we try and ask ourselves those questions, we might look online and into books, and we'll see lots of these rules or guidelines for exactly how to go about this process. Although a very prescriptive set of guidelines is probably not going to be a great idea, because it's going to need to change on a case-by-case basis to reflect what you are trying to present and what results you have. So instead of thinking of rules for presenting data, I'm going to think about some general principles for what we want our final output to look like. And the first of these rules I'm going to mention is effectiveness. If it's not highlighting the key results and the key findings that we're trying to communicate, we don't have a very good graph. It can look great, there can be all kinds of clever things going on, but if it's not getting that message across, then it's useless. The second point is to make sure it's readable. So we want to make sure everything is clearly presented, that the text that we're showing is legible, the points that we're doing, they're clearly distinct colours and they're clearly distinct shapes, if that's the intention. And that any values we can read off the graph directly as well, and that information is being presented in a format that can be absorbed. And on top of that, we also want there to be enough context behind that information. We want it to be informative. So we need titles and labels to make sure it's clear what variables are being presented and where the data's come from, so that somebody looking at this has enough context to see what this plot represents. And I guess a final principle I'm going to mention today is just making sure it's tidy, making sure it looks nice and isn't cluttered, or there isn't just an overly large amount of white space, and that the elements of the table and graph, they're well positioned, they're well defined, we're using sensible choices for colours and layouts and so on. So I'm going to start with some data where I will attack this issue of how can I go about coming up with a table or graph. It doesn't really matter what data I happen to be using here, but in this case it will be this same data set all the way through, which is just showing a few different variables from an agricultural field trial, a few different treatments which have the yield of maize, the nitrogen in the soil, and the amount of a particular infestation, striga infestation, which was observed during this agricultural trial. So it's a fairly simple data set, but even still there's lots of different ways I could be exploring this data to try and understand the difference in these treatments. So the first thing I might do is head over to Excel, and they've got a little feature in there which is recommended plots. So just for fun, I thought, okay, let's have a look at some of these recommended plots. And this was a pretty funky looking display, so I went straight ahead and clicked on it. With about two or three clicks, I got to a plot which looked like this. Unfortunately, if I am thinking about whether this is effective, readable, informative, tidy, I don't think it's any of the above. I can't see a message from this particular plot. I can see some pyramids and some kind of hills in the middle or something. But if I'm trying to understand what message this is supposed to be telling me, I have no idea. And equally, I can't really read off any values. There seem to be sort of two columns with data maybe, but then I can't really see how I can interpret what the average value is from any of these, trying to read off onto the y-axis. So I don't think it's at all readable. It's definitely not informative. There's no context at all behind any of the plot here. And it's cluttered, it's overlapping, the colours are weird. So as a plot, I think this is a bit of a failure if I see something like this in a presentation. And that's all right, I'm not very good at Excel, but I'm quite good at using R, so maybe I'll take the data over to R, spend a bit more time playing around with a few options, and maybe come up with something like this. I've used ggplot, and I've put some different panels in, and I've got some colours going on. And I guess my initial reaction to this plot is it's a bit less of an assault on my senses than the first one. It's fairly tidy, there's a fairly good use of space going on, but beyond the tidiness, I don't think we can really claim this is effective or readable or informative. Trying to see what message we're getting here from all these dots being pointed, just about the only thing I can clearly make out is that there's a relationship between the yield and the nitrogen in the soil, which we did not need to do a plot of to show that. That would be a very unsurprising finding and tells us nothing about what would be the key objectives of this kind of data analysis, which are about the different treatments. And with the readability, the different colours are not sufficiently distinct, and there's quite a lot of different colours to try and map, okay, what point refers exactly to which of the different treatments. And I don't think we have enough information at all to help us here either with understanding where this data's gone or putting labels on or anything at all to make this plot a good representation of the data. So maybe I then went, okay, I'm done with making graphs. Let's try and do a table. And more or less any software package, it's easy enough to get a table of summary statistics. Here have I guess my three key variables. But just taking the output as it's come, yes, I can now read some numbers. It's easy enough here to cross-reference my treatments and my columns to pick out some numbers. But this is not a particularly effective way of displaying the data. It's not easy to pick out what are the higher values, what are the lower values, exactly what message we'd be getting about the relationship between the different variables here. There's no information at all to tell us, okay, what do these columns represent? What do these treatments represent? Are these means? Are these medians? Are they adjusted means from some sort of model? We don't have enough information from just presenting the table like this. And it's not particularly tidy either. Mainly here I'm thinking about the decimal places. It's given us far too many decimal places. It's an inconsistent number of decimal places per row in some cases. So we could do a few things here to improve the tidiness of the table that we've seen. So instead of the table, let's go back and let's try to be a bit more careful with how we're putting things together. So now I've made a few bar charts here with the strike account on the left and the yield on the right. There's a few labels here to help us. There's a bit of information on the plots. We've got sensible axis labels, at least. We could maybe do with a bit more information from the title and from the context behind this plot in terms of what this actually means, what these treatments are. But we're on the way to something informative. I'd say we've got something reasonably tidy here in terms of how the plot is put together. I can certainly read off the different mean values and start to see, okay, which ones have higher strike count and which ones have higher yield. But showing this as a bar chart is a little bit of a controversial choice in many ways. So bar charts are not a great pick when we have continuous variables here like strike count and yield, because they can only show you a mean value. They're not showing you the variability at all. And we can also be a little bit misleading with how we draw our axes for bar charts. So in the yield plot here, I kind of cheated a little bit by moving the axis along to where the lowest value was. So it looks like the difference here between, say, treatment 5 and treatment 1, the average from just visually looking at the plot, it looks about 15, maybe 20 times bigger. The real difference is actually more like 3 times a difference, once we consider the fact that, okay, this is actually about 2.5, and treatment 1, this is actually about 6. So it's slightly misleading and making the difference look larger than it is. It's not showing us a variability, and it also makes comparison more difficult because we can only see one variable at a time. Yes, we can start trying to pick out, okay, which one of these bars refers to which treatment, and we can sort of pick out, okay, ah, yeah, treatment one, this looks like a low strike count and a high yield, and so on. But we've got to put a bit of work in to try to pull out some of these messages. So this plot, yes, it looks okay. Yes, we can read off some values, but bar charts are never usually the most effective way of presenting continuous variables. They can be much more effective when we're dealing with, say, a percentage, which has no variability inherent to it if we have 30% of farmers said X versus 60% of farmers said Y. That comparison is easier to make for a bar chart, but the comparison of averages, not so much. So let's now start thinking about what can we do to clear up some of these examples, make them more effective and more readable and tidier. So while I'm talking about bar charts, I guess the natural thing to change this to as a statistician is something like a box plot, or perhaps a violin plot would be another alternative. And so the advantage of these box plots are we don't just see the average value, but we still do see the average value in a box plot. Generally, we see the median as a line through the middle, but we're also getting a much better picture of the full range of the variable itself. And I also took an extra step here of converting this to the log axis. So this was a way of trying to improve perhaps the tidiness and the effectiveness of this plot by reducing the white space and also allowing these differences to become clearer. With something like a infestation, it's a very exponential type increase where there will be treatments like treatment one, where there's just a very small number if it's very effective. But these numbers will quickly spiral out of control into the hundreds and thousands and so on. So it makes a lot of sense here to use a log axis, both scientifically and also from a presentation point of view. And there's something quite interesting that we can pick out that we really would not have seen at all from the bar charts. So there are three treatments here where the average values are all quite similar, but the average values are all quite similar for very different reasons. So treatment two, this has some low counts and some high counts and a whole lot of variability in the middle. Treatment four, this has quite a few sort of moderately low counts, but then one very high count, which is skewing the average up. And then treatment seven, this is one where it's quite consistent with the results and it's kind of consistently in the middle. So all three of these are similar in terms of their mean, but for very different reasons. And the box plot can really nicely identify that, but the bar chart cannot. And it's useful here to think that we might need to come up with more than one display to help show different aspects of our data. We're not going to show everything all in one plot. So when we're thinking of this comparison across different variables, instead of having one plot for yield, one plot for Striga, what we could do is use a scatter plot and show the average values. So we're still not showing the variability, but we are now seeing the comparison between the two variables. And I've chosen here, instead of trying to label nine different kinds of color for the nine different treatments, there's plenty of space to actually just put the text onto the plot, where it becomes much easier now to read off which treatment is which. And it's pretty clear we want something with a high yield and a low Striga count. And this treatment number one immediately jumps out as being in the perfect corner up here of having high yield and low disease. And treatment number eight is in exactly the wrong corner here, where it's got a very high disease count and a very low yield. And the treatment number five is maybe a little bit interesting. It's very resistant to disease, but very low yielding. And the rest here are somewhere in the middle. Now we don't see the variability here, but what we do see is this trade-off between the two variables. And a scatter plot here is going to help show that in a way which other ways of looking at the data will not. And taking the mean values here, this helps those issues that we saw in the plot that we made earlier with those three scatter plots side by side, where there was just too many points to pick out the trends clearly. And let's think also about the table that we made before. So there's a bunch of different improvements that we can make to this table, all of which are fairly simple. Things just like labeling the treatments instead of having them coded as 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. Things like tidying up the columns so that they're all to the same number of significant figures. And adding in informative headers telling us exactly what is used in each of the columns. So saying what each variable is, not just having the code for the variable, and what the summary statistic we have in each column is. Perhaps the little trick here is adding in this nice conditional formatting so that within each column, within each variable, we can kind of highlight which ones are doing well, like the S-span treatment. We've seen that already doing very well. It's green in all different variables here. And perhaps other ones which have a trade-off between being good at some aspects and bad at other aspects. Perhaps the L-leuco treatment here is a good example of this, which was high yielding, but also had fairly high disease scores. So putting in elements like this conditional formatting can make our tables much more effective, as well as here we've added in things to help the informativeness and the tidiness. So how should we be thinking of applying these principles more generally? And I think the key tools are perhaps not being really fancy with software and having a good understanding of lots of different software packages, because it's possible to make good plots in almost any software package, but not by accepting the default options. What you really need is time and experimentation and reflection. And you need to spend some time working through the visual display to make sure it is effective and readable and informative and tidy. And the best way of getting to that is experimentation. Doing some trial and error, trying out different ideas, looking at different options. There's never going to be a single correct way of creating a plot or a table, but as you're trying out different things, there will be ones which will work better for your purposes, and you should see ones which don't work at all for your purposes. And it's a good idea to maybe reflect before you go any further and say, okay, what if I've never seen this plot or this table before? Could I still make sense of what I've done if I'm coming to this completely fresh? And if not, then it's time for a bit more iteration and a bit more practice to try to apply these principles in reality.